valuation. Yesterday, we were talking about air gun and the effect of both air bubble and the ghost. To refresh your mind, just trying to show you the feature of puppets. These are the puppets generated, expansion, then contracted, and then expansion again, contracted, and moving upward. The puppets are moving upward. Here are the amplitudes associated, the pressures associated with these puppets. And here is a signature on the record, on the time series record and seismic traces. Again, this has the pressure of the gap of the bulbs. This is the how the distribution of the pressure of the puppets with time. Here we have the boom, the first shock of the air gun, and here we have TS is the rise time, taken to have the maximum amplitude. PS is the peak pressure. Theta S is the time to hydrostatic pressure. This is the hydrostatic pressure. Theta 1 after flow time. T1 is the bubble period. This is a complete bubble period. Theta 1 is the second expansion, and pH is the hydrostatic pressure. So this define the main parameter of the puppet pressure recorded by any instrument, any seismic instrument. So the left-hand side represents the output of one air gun. The right-hand side represents the desires. I am desiring to have an impulsive source so that the resolution of the seismic section is good. Thus, to arrive to this picture from this one, I am using an array of air gun. Okay, so to remove the effect of puppets, we use an array of air guns. These air guns are spaced at certain distances, not the same distances, and also the volumes of each of these air guns are not the same. This illustrates the situation. Now I have six individual air guns. Here we have six curves representing the pressure released from the air gun, and of course the ghost and the bubble effect for each of these. You see that different air guns with different dimensions and different distances do have a change in phase. Do you understand phase? We have in this part they are nearly in phase, but from here we experience difference in phase with about pi divided by 2, about 90 degree angles. This makes when they are antiphase, makes the amplitude very much reduced or even totally removed. And this makes use of a very important principle, which is called superposition. This is a representation of the superposition principle. The energy from each of this air gun move in the media, in the water, without any interaction with the other air guns. But at certain point, at the observation point, the resulting amplitude is the sum or the vectorial sum of this waveform. So, in case we have waves are in phase, so we have high amplitude, the amplitude sums up. In case we have out of phase or antiphase, we have lower amplitude. Thus, we obtain our desired seismic source wavelet, which is shown here in red. You see the summation of this waveform, this pressure, they are in phase, so the amplitude extended. You can also see, figure out the same situation for the stacking. Something like we have amplitude summing up, they are in phase, so the amplitude increase. So we can think of this as also an illustration of stacking, but here stacking for the shot. However, the later the tail of the response is out of phase or antiphase, so the amplitude is either near zero or very low. So summing the signal of multiple guns creates a more desirable signal. Note the relative scales of the left and right plots. He wants to point out that to pay our attention about the red amplitude we have in the right one compared with the blue amplitudes in the left one. Here is an example of an array of air guns of different volume. We have 500 inch square, we have 500 inch cube, 290 inch cube, 195 inch cube, and so on, till 54 inch cube. So it's evident that we have different in the air bubble, in the place, in the time taken for the air bubble. So summing up this waveform produces the sum here, which is this one, where the effect of air bubble here nearly totally removed. We have also another factor, the factor of depth compared to the seawater surface. We have source at 3 meter depth, 6 meter depth, 9 meter depth, and 12 meter depth. Okay, you can see that at shallower depths, the effect of bubbles is smaller, while at deeper depths the effect is higher. The right hand side represents the frequency. Okay, so we hope to get this type of response, which looks like the spike or the delta function, or we call it white spectrum. White spectrum, to refresh your memory, is that spectrum that have nearly constant amplitude for all frequency. The white spectrum produce high resolution in the time domain. So if we are looking for small thickness, thin beds, we need to have high resolution. So we need to have spike or impulsive source. We discussed earlier something about near field and far field. So here is a definition of the near field or near zone and the far zone. And it is related to the wavelengths concept. The term near field and far field radiation zone are associated with some confusion in terms of seismic source description because different definitions are used. In physics, if the source dimensions are of order d, so we may think in length unit, the source is say 1 meter, for example, and the wavelength is L equal C divided by F, where C is the velocity and F is the frequency. So here we are in the water, so C is the velocity of water, of sound in water, and F is the frequency associated with it. And here R is the radius, is the distance from the source to observation point. Then there are three special regions of interest. The near zone, in this zone, the distance lies between the dimension of the source and the wavelength. So if you are in this zone, we are in the near zone. In this part, or in this zone, we have tremendous effect from heterogeneity. So if we have some record from near zone, you will find irregularity and you find random motion, a lot of random motion. These random motions are from heterogeneities and from source effect. At near zone, we are so sensitive to source effect. The intermediate zone, where the distance is near the wavelengths, and the far zone, where the distance is greater than both the source dimension and the wavelengths we are dealing with, here the effect or the short period characteristics of the source is not present, and we have the long period characteristics. So we have to keep in mind when we speak about near field and or near zone and far zone. Back to the problem of air gun, which is called the ghost. Now the air gun is fired and the energy move in all directions, but we are interested in the energies that move downward towards the seabed and then to the crustal structure. Other type of energy moves upward and reflected at the sea surface, the water surface, and then reflect back parallel to the original wave field. Why you call this ghost? Because it seems like we have an image of this source above the sea water surface, and this this source produce energy, And of course, you see, it is reversed in polarity. So if we assume the pulse is compression, we have released the pressure, so we produced compression. Okay, you are following me, or? The bubble, the air gun, when it's fired, it produces compressional field. Compressional field means from the source, the particles are pushed away. Okay? But for the ghost, due to the negative reflection coefficient here, we have reverse in polarity. So we have dilation, like tension, like the particle is moved towards the source. So it's like we have two sources, one with compressional waves and the other one, imaginary one, with dilation. Like you grab something, you take the particle to you in your direction. So this is called dilatation. You know longitudinal waves? Sound waves? Have you studied sound waves?
Yes.
Sound wave is longitudinal waves. And longitudinal waves is compression and rarefaction. So at the source we have compression, and also we have rarefaction, the restoring force that causes the particles to return back to its present place. The other one is rarefaction. The imaginary source is rarefaction. So we will have the ghost effect. We have some the features that we have seen before. This one is a ghost. Now, the picture is even more complicated. The energy moved from the source downward to the crust, or to Earth's material, Earth's rocks, and then we have refraction, reflection, and so on, and get back to the surface. But here we have the water bed. In water bed, we have this one will go up, and we have ghost. And then this one will be reflected at the seabed surface and reflected back upward. Then it will meet the seawater surface where it reflects, and so on. So this is called multiples. Okay? Multiple, which mean I have multiple reflection from the same interface. Okay, so it may looks like this. Suppose this is the signature of a reflector. Then it will repeat again. So from the same reflector, we will have two reflection energy coming, maybe three, maybe four. In case of water, we may have some feature called reverberations. Reverberations, you will find many multiples on the seismic trace. So this call this the true, and this is multiple. And this multiple occurs whenever energy comes up. Because when suppose we have reflection here and it comes here and then up, it will record it and then also will meet the sea level, the sea surface reflected back and also make bubbles. So the situation due to the seabed is complex and requires work seismic data processing to remove the effect of multiples. Now we have to define the parameters that determine the survey. We have these items taken from Ashton et al. 1994. We have we start by the signal to noise ratio. So this is one of the important issues. We also need to have idea about near trace offset, useful offsets, group intervals, cross line spacings, spatial frequency to avoid spatial aliasing. Suppose I have feature like this in the subsurface. So in order to be able to detect this feature without avoiding aliasing, I should have geophone here and geophone here, at least. These are the least geophones to have. So this is delta X, contrary to delta T in time domain. So if I'm looking for features in this, which is about 2 delta X, I should change geophone intervals or group intervals at delta X, not exceeding delta X. Because if I'm having only one point here, I may not see the feature completely. Okay? Suppose this is the anticline syncline series. So if you are using large spacing, large geophone spacing, you are either misinterpreting the subsurface feature or even not seeing this feature at all. Spatial resolution, which means that the bandwidth of data, shoot point intervals, migration aperture, how much offset is needed for migration, shooting directions, which is related with azimuth, we're going to speak about this later, and also the record length, which means what is the maximum time to record. What is the maximum time to record? You know, I have in my computer and your computer, we have limited memory and limited storage. So I'm trying to design optimum experiment to have the time, the required time to get the data from the required targets. I'm not looking for so deep targets, deeper than my target or my objectives. So I have to limit, to choose proper record length. If I choose short record length, I will not record the target depths I'm looking for. If I choose too long recording length, of course I will get my target, but costing a lot of on the expense of the computer memory, so that I may end up with the experiment is shut down because the computer ran out of memory or ran out of storage available. So, to review, what are the main components of the marine seismic survey? The main components are the seismic vessel. In this vessel, there is a control room, processing facilities, etc., which this is the brain of our experiment. This is the brain of our experiment. Then we have the source. We have mostly array of air guns or water guns or boomer or ship. We have many types of marine seismic sources, and also we have marine seismic sources that make sweeps like vibrosites. But the air guns are the mostly used because it produce impulsive response, and also it produces high frequency and high energy compared to others, because the others produce weak energy and sometimes weak low frequency. And then we have the streamer cable, in which in the streamer cables we have the hydrophones, and last but not least, okay, the positioning device. Without the positioning device, we are lost. Okay? If you move a beam here, you say, okay, this is the wrong something, this is Aslan Shah, Jalan Aslan Shah, this USM, this, and so some guy Dua, some guy Arab, so you have routes to follow. But in the sea, there is no features. So you can say, I have decided something. Okay? Like desert. In the desert, you are lost if you don't have a navigation system. Lost, and a friend of, colleagues, not a friend, colleagues, lost his life because he lost in the desert, although he died in a place so near to highway, but he didn't know. If he know, he can move to this place, but he unfortunately he couldn't. So the navigation is very important in desert, and it's very important, very, very important in sea. So, in previous slides, we gave you the ideal distribution where the streamer is straight. But actually, this is not the case. The streamer is not straight, it's wavy like in this slide, because we may have some water waves in our course, in our movement. We have water waves, we have some effects from other maybe far or near passing ship or something. So this should be taken into consideration. We have to locate these streamers very, and the position of each hydrophone precisely, or else all our work is error. If I'm depending only on here at the float or the buoy or here at the vessel only, so we end up with erroneous location, erroneous model of the subsurface. So here we have many tools to try to adjust and to correct for these differences. So this symbol, this one is the surface navigation. This is like antenna. So we have here antenna at the vessel, and we have antennas at the float. We have also here acoustic nodes. These acoustic nodes will know the use of these nodes. And this is the heading of the sensors. And this one is the acoustic path. You mean, you know acoustic, what's the meaning of acoustic? You don't know, and you're silent, feeling silent, not asking what's the meaning of acoustic? That's sound. So that's sound waves. So how our survey is conducted? The survey is conducted commonly using the race track pattern. So the vessels move in this direction, and then it turn around and then move in this direction and so on. So our marine seismic lights is carried out in race track pattern. Now we have the streamer. The streamer, as we said, contains the hydrophone and contains also nodes, acoustic nodes. These acoustic nodes are useful for navigation, as we were going to explain later. So for marine seismic experiment, we have one or more streamers, maybe 20 streamers. The length of these streamers from 3 to 12 kilometers long. And the lens, it should be long to cope with all conditions. We may have waves, we may looking for deeper interface and so on. Cable contains few hundred for hydrophones, each 12 to 25 or 25 meters. So we have the hydrophone here at 12.5 or 25 meter, embedded in liquid of foam-like structure, buoyant and digitizing and transmitting electronics. So, like here, it is embedded in some sort of foam to keep the instrument, the hydrophone, to keep it floating. Hydrophone based on piezoelectric effect, we'll explain this piezoelectric effect in the next slide. X-line spacing, cross spacing, often 100 meters. So between each streamer, it's often about 100 meter spacing. Near offset, typically around 150 meters. Towing depth is critical parameter for bandwidths. For too deep, lack of frequency is both low frequency and high frequency, which is a result of ghost notch. Too shallow, 6 meter or so, it's noisy because you have the effect of waves from above. So shallow means high resolution, deep means deep penetration, and this is not my lecture, so it's not another lecture. So the typical towing depth is 8 meters. Excuse me? Yes, compared to sea surface. Now, this is a hydrophore. This is a certain kind of crystals. There are certain kinds of crystal like cesium. When it's compressed, it produces electricity. So, of course, we cannot depend on electromagnetic because it's heavy and it's not buoyant, and also because we are dealing now here, we are dealing with pressure other than mechanical vibration. So, the hydrophone, or sometimes called transducers, is composed of this crystal, piezoelastic crystal. When we have compression, it is compressed, and this compressed, when it's compressed, it produces electricity. The electricity depends on the direction and the magnitude of the pressure caused on the crystal. So it's another kind of differentiation. It's another kind of mechanical electrical energy conversion. We had idea about electromagnetic, and now we have idea about piezoelectric effect. And the piezometric or piezoelectric is used in many cases for groundwater. If you want to monitor the level of the water in water wells, you also deploy piezometric devices. It will record the difference in elevation. Now, to the most important part in our experiment, the positioning control. Because if we cannot position ourselves, we cannot move, we cannot do anything. We used back in, when I was in your age, study field geology to try how to orient myself in the field, and we study surveying to know how to put my points on the map, and how to put the points I am observing on the map. And I hope you have the same here also, because it's very important when you go outside. Luckily, you most of your work in near urban area, but maybe your condition drive you to some other location where there is no urban, there is nobody you can ask how to go here or there. So in this case, you will depend on maybe GPS and a map so that you can find your way. At that time, we don't have GPS, so we used the canvas and the teleolith and so on. So the positioning control for the marine seismic survey, we have sensors to detect deviations, which is the acoustic nodes. Okay? We have positioning determined by DGPS. So what is the letter D? The letter D means differential global positioning system. Last month we went to Langkawi for a seismic experiment, and we have the GPS, and we positioned our lines. But when we go back, get back and map the lines, we found change. I estimated to be about 120 meters error in the GPS. Excuse me?
Why?
Why? Yes. Because. Because many reasons. The first one, the accuracy of the instrument. So maybe the instrument here is not so accurate to produce, because some GPS produce accuracy few meters, and maybe less than meters. And also because you know GPS depends on satellite technology, and this satellite technology is used for civilian and military operations. For military operation, they used very, and the signal produced is very sensitive, very accurate to get the accurate position. Say, for example, if one of the superpower tried to launch ballistic rocket, so it will guide, it will be guided by the GPS system. So suppose a terrorist have GPS and put this technology on a record, on a rocket, and then he want to be guided, this error produce that the rocket will miss its target by 10 meter, 50 meter, 100 meter or so on. So it's something for military action. You cannot, they cannot give you this high accuracy. And also due to the instrument you use itself. So I guess our instrument here is good, but we have to take to keep in mind its accuracy is within tens of meters. It's not so accurate. So we have to use the DGBS, which means you have to incorporate both the measurements used by GPS and measuring the GPS reading at point where all information, where the location is totally known. For example, now we are at School of Physics. School of Physics, if you go to Google Maps, you will get longitude and latitude accurately. So you can use this as a reference station. And then refer all data you read to this station and see how the error, you estimate the error, and then remove this error to get accurate GPS. You didn't understand. I feel like fragmented. So, my GPS has, say, 30 meter error. Now I'm going to USM and put my instrument and measure the latitude and longitude using my GPS. I will define the difference. Then I will go to other places, use my GPS, and refer to the same, to USM, to define the error, and then remove the error from the new obtained source. No. Again, no, don't understand it. Like calibration. So I'm measuring here longitude and latitude at USM. The longitude and latitude of USM is totally known, it's known, okay? So the reading of the GPS, there will be error according to the error, and this error is changeable depending on the weather and so on, okay? So I will define the error. We have error, say 20 meters in the northeast direction. So I go to other places and measure, keeping in mind that I have, say, 20 meter in northeast direction, and finally return to USM and measure, use the GPS to see the difference, the change in the error, because I told you the error changed due to the condition of the atmosphere. So this is called differential GPS. To use other points to control the location of my location. Excuse me? Yes?
The error?
I guess the conventional now is about 15 meters.
15?
Yes, that can, you can, I think you can buy from market. But with differential, you can go down to 30 centimeters, 20 centimeters. Yeah. So it's required to do so. And also, I'm telling you, you have to take care, because here in Malaysia, the weather is usually cloudy. You have this cloud make delay for the signal, and thus the satellite depends on analyzing the travel time from the satellite to the instrument, and also to use the calculations of the location. The signal includes the location, longitude, latitude, elevation of each of the satellite. So in something like finding the locus, you have three cones at least. This cone to one satellite, and another one to another satellite, and another one for another satellite. The instrument try to solve the geometrical problem to define the location of you, depending on the locations of the satellites used and the travel time taken from. For the signal from the satellite at about 22,000 kilometers to the station. So if this signal delay due to atmospheric effect, it will have effect on the accuracy of the GPS. Tail wheels, paravanes, and source loads adjust the deviations, like feathering position inaccuracy. Depth controlled by birds, and something like the acoustic points is put with wings, something like wings to try to adjust the depths of the stream. By a barefoot movement similar to an airplane wing, heavy weather, sea currents, water density variation. Recently, steered streamers with high positioning accuracy are being used, where you can put the you can detect the position with nearly all the points of the stream. So we have the navigation up, and here is the GPS in the vessel, and here also. And we have these are separations. The streamer, there are the acoustic stations that you know, like total station sending signal and receiving signal to define the difference in these distances, so that With a computer program, we can define the actual position of our stream. This is the streamer, the steering joint. So you see how the streamer looks like, and it's also kept parallel, and also the location of each geophone is accurately defined. These are the verbs that are used for trying to keep the depths and also the direction for the streamer to try to straighten the one, or even to keep track of the change from the straight line.